I'm Dr. Kathleen Olive. Welcome to Limelight Arts Travels Art Podcast, A Closer Look. Some works of art have been loved for so many centuries or even millennia that they feel an effortless part of our cultural repertoire. But how well do we really know them? In this episode, I'm joined by art historian and specialist guide Freya Middleton. Freya has postgraduate degrees in Italian Renaissance studies and has lived and worked in Florence, Italy for more than two decades. Today, she considers Botticelli's Spring one of the best-loved works of art in Florence's Uffizi Gallery. Freya opens up the intellectual and philosophical world of a Florentine Renaissance elite for us, and she explains what lies behind our continued love of Botticelli today.
Thanks very much for coming in to join us today, Freya.
Oh, my pleasure.
And you have selected today to talk to us about an absolute icon of not just Italian, but Western European painting. Can you please tell us what artwork you're going to talk to us about today?
The absolutely fabulous Primavera or Springtime painting by Sandro Botticelli in the Uffizi Gallery in Florence, which is, as you said, I mean, an absolute icon of Italian Renaissance painting. Very excited.
Yes, and well, we're very excited to have you here talking about an artwork that I know you love. I'm sure people listening along are reasonably familiar with Botticelli's Spring, but in case they can't quite call it immediately to mind, would you please describe this painting for people who are listening today?
Yes, absolutely. So it is the medium that's used is egg tempera on wood panel, and it's extremely large. In fact, now for those who have reasonably recently visited the Uffizi Gallery in Florence, you can actually see it very well now, which is fantastic with the new lighting that they installed about maybe 5 or 6 years ago now. And it's what's really fun is that you can actually see when you stand to the side, you can actually see the undulating waves of the very slight, but you have to get it with the glare, the undulating waves of the wood panels that he put together. And I guess they'd probably be about 10. In any case, it's a very large painting with eight figures that we're actually going to go through from right to left, eight almost life-size figures with also fabulous little flying Cupid, Venus's son at the top. And it's a painting that Sandro Botticelli painted in the early 1480s. And it has become one of the best known works by Botticelli. He did a few of these mythological paintings in the 1480s commissioned by the Medici family. And they really have become not just some of the most famous works that he personally did, but also iconic representations, almost like billboard manifestos for the 15th century Florentine Renaissance. And so that's why it's so fun to kind of unpack this famous one with you today.
Tell us a little bit about these characters, Freya. I'm sure people can call to mind all of these elegant men and women in those groups that you've mentioned, kind of disporting on the flowery field in the woods. But they're clearly really symbolic or personified characters. So who are we looking at? Who are these people?
Let's dive on deep and say that the names, and people might be recalling right now also another very famous painting, and often they're viewed usually one after another when you visit the Uffizi Gallery. So we're going to be talking about the Springtime today, where, as we mentioned, there are numerous figures. And then the other one that often is, and it's more or less the same size, a little smaller, is the Birth of Venus. But both of these paintings have as their main theme Venus, the goddess of love and beauty. And in our painting today, in Springtime, she is shown as the center, as a focal point of the painting, but she has surrounding her these other demigods, nymphs, goddesses, and so forth. And so, indeed, the name Springtime, these paintings weren't names. In fact, we have very limited documentation with this painting at all. It was for many years believed to have been commissioned by Lorenzo the Magnificent of the Medici family, who in the 1480s was the unofficial ruler of the Florentine Republic. And now it could still be commissioned by him, but it could also have been commissioned by his second cousin, Pier Lorenzo de Medici. They lived next door to one another in any case. So either Lorenzo the Magnificent commissioned it and possibly gave it to his second cousin as a gift, as a wedding gift. His second cousin had just married, or Pier Lorenzo commissioned it directly from Botticelli himself. Regardless, it was located in the city home of this second cousin of Lorenzo the Magnificent, Pier Lorenzo. And it was, a document was discovered in the late 1490s as describing a certain important room in Pier Lorenzo's house. And it seems that one of the paintings described in this document most likely was this Springtime painting. It was called Springtime, though, in the following century. It was referred to as Springtime by Giorgio Vasari in The Lives of His Artists when he's describing Botticelli's life. But this painting with this fabulous array of different gods and goddesses and so forth possibly could have been the decoration above a daybed in this important room on the first floor of Pier Lorenzo's home, which happened to be located next to Lorenzo the Magnificent's home. And so this would be something that, therefore, this very large painting seen in this sitting room, this important sitting room, would be maybe something that would spark conversation about what these gods stand for, in particular love and poetry. And the whole context is this idea of maybe the rebirth of springtime with Flora, who's present, and Chloris and Zephyr, the west wind, and these nymphs, and they look pregnant, like maybe this idea of rebirth and so forth. And so they'd be discussing philosophy that was therefore, you know, and the meaning of their lives. And this analogy of spring maybe represents this idea of the Renaissance in the 15th century Florence, this rebirth of knowledge and awareness after the Dark Ages. So that's why this seemingly, you know, simple mythological painting, in fact, is really an icon of this whole century, or at least of the second half of the 15th century in Florence, which was so really kind of the cornerstone for the concept of humanism and this rebirth of on the centrality of man.
You've said that we can assume that in its original context, people were sitting around and discussing the meaning of this painting. And so presumably that means there's some level of ambivalence built into the very scene itself. Do you think we're also supposed to read all of the objects in this painting symbolically? It strikes me when I look at it, there is so much detail, individual flowers, the kind of tasseled bells on the robe of the figure of Venus in the center. There's so much detail. Are we supposed to read that detail in a symbolic way, or does Botticelli just love the detail?
That's such a great question. And I love the mere fact that it is ambivalent, of course, which sparks it can spark therefore different avenues of conversation. So the fact if it was, let's look at it just quite simply and in a way superficially, but in a very, you know, frivolous and lovely way, let's look at it as a wedding present from Lorenzo to Pier Lorenzo, who just married the lovely Semiramide d'Appiano in the early 1480s. And therefore this concept of Venus, the goddess of love, who's shown with this wonderful myrtle tree kind of behind her, an evergreen tree referring to therefore the eternal love of this newly wedded couple. And here she is in this wonderfully flourishing spring wood with, as you said, orange trees, which was a symbol therefore kind of this idea of, you know, of health that will hopefully therefore this long-ranging health, which will give them great happiness in their life, and this great sense of the fertility with the pregnancy that you can feel, or at least the full-bodied women that you've got and so forth. So taking it on as that, it's this wonderfully happy gift. But then we can also look at it as this idea of a more philosophical connotation, and indeed that would then spark a different type, maybe later an after-chen, doppel-chen, in the after-chen. So maybe the wonderful idea of spring before dinner, with having your aperitivo, speaking of this kind of happiness. And then after dinner, maybe getting into a more philosophical tone of exactly what your essence of living your life on this earth is all about. Because both Lorenzo the Magnificent and Pietro Lorenzo were brought up by the same tutors. They were brought up in this wonderfully Renaissance humanitas. In fact, some people say that the central figure could also be not necessarily only Venus, but also representative of the personification of humanitas. But also as well, looking at the colors that she's wearing, the Venus, she's wearing a fabulously rendered white robe of wonderfully light colored, light fabric. And she's got this blue and red mantle kind of also shimmering off her shoulders. And of course, they're the colors that are usually referencing we see on the Virgin Mary. So could this painting other layer be therefore the divine mediatrix, the Virgin Mary, or the giver of life, the great intercessor? So this wonderful Christian referencing also with this mythological connotation. And so is this, we can read it in a neo-Platonic key. So let's go, I put a whiskey in your hands. It's kind of after a dinner discussion of the philosophical view, neo-Platonic view on the on what you're supposed to do on earth, how you're supposed to live your life in order to gain your entry into heaven, the ascendance of the soul. So if we read these figures now from the right to the left in Neoplatonic key, we can discover this, a more deeper meaning. Let's say that the woman, the man we definitely know is Zephyr on the right-hand side. We can tell he's got this kind of a bluish color, like kind of a fresh wind coming through, rustling the trees. And indeed, we can tell that he's also the wind as he flies through the trees, because he's got fabulous wings on. And he's actually catching onto a woman. He's grabbed a woman in front of her, and she's noticeably shocked. You know, she's not smiling. She was obviously, it looks as if she's running away from him. So already he was gaining upon her in the wood, and he's grabbed onto her, and she's kind of turned around. You can see that she's a bit frightened, or at least, you know, certain nervousness about her. And then we see this vine coming out of her mouth. And if we trace where the vine goes, it then entangles itself in the wonderfully rendered by Botticelli flowers of the dress of the woman who looks completely composed next to her. And in fact, this is Flora. And the story that we know that's recounted from the poems from antiquity is that Zephyr is attracted and finds the wood nymph Flora when floating through the trees and ravishes her, takes advantage of her, and she appeals to the gods and is transformed into the goddess of flowers. So we see her transformation with the three figures on the right-hand side of the painting. And so this could represent indeed in a Neoplatonic fashion the part of our nature, the matter, the bestial nature that we should keep intact so that we can therefore give more attention to our inner beauty, our God-given talent, our soul, our mind, so that it can train the bestial matter in us to creating greatness in our life on earth, which will therefore start the ascent of our soul to heaven. And so we need to concentrate and give time for beauty to grow in us so that we can create great acts of beauty on the exterior with our matter. And thus why possibly this central woman can be taken as therefore the personification of our greatness that we have inside of us that we need to set free. So here we have Venus. But also, as you can feel how these Platonic ideas were meshed with the Christianity in the 15th century, and thus how Venus is clothed like the Virgin herself. But we have love, amor, above Venus, indeed, because it is through the love of one another and the love of God that we will be able to elevate our soul already in our ascent. to heaven on earth. So here we have Cupid blindfolded. He's blindfolded and he's ready to shoot an arrow off to make someone fall blindly or madly in love, or to follow the pursuit of love. And he's firing it off to these wonderful three women. So we're kind of working from the right to the left. We've said that there's Zephyr and then Chorus, who turns into Flora, the rebirth of the greatness of man, if we're viewing it in a philosophical key, with Venus in the center, as it's all centered around the love of man and the greatness that man can create as we're using our God-given gifts. Moving on to the three graces, as indeed like the exterior of how we hold ourselves and our actions belie the greatness on our of our interior. So the graces that move with this lyrical, they're moving, these three women are shown dressed similarly and they're moving in this wonderful lyrical dance, the way in which they're Botticelli paints their feet and the transparency of the robes that they're wearing to show the silhouette of their body and the beautiful way that one cocks her head. And so you've got this wonderful unified dance. You can see the great harmony that will be created by man if he moves to the greatness of his interior that he's working on. And then one of these three graces is looking to the last personage on our painting, who's Mercury, that we can recognize because he's got wings at the back of his sandals and he's holding a caduceus, that fabulous staff of his with the two entwined snakes. And he's pointing this staff upwards, though, through clouds. So could the concept be that if you therefore start the ascent of your soul and elevate yourself above the bestial actions of man, who's driven not by his interior humanitas, but by his bestial nature, then he will forever remain stuck and grounded on earth, like with the common animals in general, the animal kingdom. But his staff with these snakes entwined, supposedly the idea is the origin of his staff is that there were two snakes fighting and he planted the staff in between them and caused peace. So this idea of control of the body and peace that one creates when you're ruled by your interior greatness and your humanitas given by God, and therefore that soul will start its a peaceful ascent to heaven. So there's this wonderful sense of movement from right to left, but created by Botticelli with this fabulous undulating sense of lyricism in his painting by the way in which he's got the heads of all the figures slightly different levels and they ebb and flow. You've got Venus is set back from these other figures in the foreground, as if she, you know, love rules over all. Indeed, as we mentioned before, that the myrtle branches around her create this kind of halo. It truly is, you know, Botticelli was said to be, he is that great painter to really represent these philosophical ideas and these discussions that the Medici family and their circle were having on a daily or a weekly basis. And of what exactly the virtue of man. And so his paintings, really the harmony with which, you know, this is done and that sense of lyricism, the beautiful colour palette. And Kathleen mentioned, you know, the wonderful choice of the flowers that he's got. It's incredible to think that supposedly there are about 500 different species of flora in this painting alone, and almost 200 of them are flowers, identified flowers, which is just astounding. So this love of the world in which we live and the greatness that we can do when participating it with a conscious level of humanitas.
Freya, it's such a beautiful interpretation that you've given of what's quite clearly a highly sophisticated work of art, something that is speaking in its own moment to an educated intellectual elite, such as the circle of the Medici family in 15th century Florence. But this work still draws so many people, together with the birth of Venus, as you said, to the Uffizi Gallery in Florence. It's used, you know, in countless advertising campaigns. Venus was recently used by the Italian government as the face of an entire tourism campaign to Italy. So by way of conclusion, can you share with us, as someone who's spent a lot of time as a specialist guide in Florence, standing in front of this painting and explaining it to people, what do you think it is that draws so many different kinds of viewers to this artwork year after year?
I think that's a great question. I think that what is so interesting is that we are, just as Leonardo da Vinci believed, you know, the eye was the entranceway to the entryway to the soul, and in this period in the 15th century, they believed, therefore, this idea that we always look twice, you do a double take at beauty, because your interior beauty, that the soul in us, is therefore like a magnet, will be drawn to other elements of beauty. And it's and so I think that that's what Botticelli so wonderfully portrayed, a sense that we sometimes, people obviously can't explain why they like it. Is it the formal representation of the way in which Botticelli has shown the figures in their placement with one another, shown as this wonderfully attractive setting with these fabulous flowers and the luscious forest that they find themselves in, where they're so clearly at ease? Is it this wonderful transparency of the fabric? It's beauty generally that Botticelli, though, happens to bring together as a feast for the eyes. I think that that's it. So I like the idea that inexplicably we are drawn to beauty because we do search out the best that we can make as man on and humankind on earth. And that's a lovely feeling. However, it is something that people, you're absolutely right, people spend more time on. It's a feast for the eyes, but it's done in a manner that gives us also a sense of peace at the same time. So even without the explanation, the philosophical explanation, the kind of going deeper into it, Botticelli, indeed, his great gift to the world, and if we're going to look at it in a Platonic key, his gift from God was indeed painting, being able to bring together different formal aspects such as composition and form and colour and so forth in such a lyrical manner that we are, our eyes, our entry to our soul, is drawn to it as, you know, one great thing to another.
Freya Middleton, thank you so much for encouraging us to look twice at Botticelli's Spring.
Oh, thank you so much for inviting me to do so.
You've been listening to Limelight Arts Travels podcast, A Closer Look. It was recorded on the lands of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and we acknowledge and pay our respects to the traditional custodians of this land and their elders past and present.